Ladies and gentlemen, it is now my privilege to introduce our guest speaker tonight, Professor Jürgen Moltmann. Jürgen Moltmann was born on April the 8th, 1926 in Hamburg. He began to study theology as a prisoner of war in England. Returning home in 1948, he continued his studies at Göttingen University, where he received his doctorate in 1952. He became a professor at a seminary of the Confessing Church in Wuppertal, 1958. In 1963, he accepted a call to a chair of systematic theology and social ethics at the Protestant faculty of Bonn University. In 1967, he became professor of systematic theology at the University of Tübingen, where he retired in 1994. Several prestigious prizes were awarded to him. Inter alia, the Italian Prize for Literature of the Isola de Elba, Amos Comenius Medal at Bethlehem, Pennsylvania, Ernst Bloch Prize of the city of Ludwigshafen, Grafemeyer Award of Religion in Louisville, Kentucky. He was awarded 16 honorary doctorates inter alia by the following universities: Duke University, Bethlehem Theological Seminary, Kalamazoo College, Radai College in Budapest, St. Andrews University, Emory University, Catholic University of Louvain, Orthodox University of Iasi, Romania, Nottingham University, Managua, Nicaragua, Chungyang University, Taiwan. Moltmann was co-editor of the Deutsch-Polnische Hefte, 1959 to 1968, and worked for reconciliation between Poland and Germany. He participated in the Christian Marxist dialogues. For 20 years, he was a member of the Faith and Order Committee of the World Council of Churches, 1963 to 1983. He was editor of the journal Evangelische Theologie, and from 1979 to 1994, one of the directors of the Catholic journal Concilium. His many books have all been translated into the leading world languages. Professor Moltmann was married to Dr. Elizabeth Moltmann Wendel, and he has today 4 children. First and foremost, Professor Moltmann, I want to express my sincere gratitude for accepting our Vice Chancellor invitation that an honorary doctorate could be conferred on him by the University of Pretoria. This is the first honorary doctorate to Professor Moltmann by an African university. We are highly honored for this. After 40 years, Professor Moltmann has returned to South Africa, and this time, Professor Moltmann, we receive you with honor and the respect you deserve. One reads in his autobiography that his first and previous visit to South Africa in 1978 was not a pleasant one. Prior to that, in 1974, a visa was refused to him by the then South African government. And during his 1978 visit, the apartheid atrocities moved him deeply. He was termed by the Christian League of the time as, quote, a revolutionary in a theologian's doctoral gown. Professor Moltmann wrote in his autobiography that on his flight back to home from South Africa in 1978, he had resolved never to return to South Africa until the apartheid system has ceased to exist. Therefore, I was so excited when I visited him last year, July the 3rd, and invited him to be associated with our centenary. I took along all the relevant material with regards to our transformation at university, the faculty. I even took the faculty plan of the university to Professor Moltmann, and of course a copy of our vision and mission and the emphasis on plural versality and inclusivity. This convinced him, and I was overwhelmed that morning by his affirmation to visit Pretoria. Ladies and gentlemen, I am convinced that a clear association of Professor Moltmann with the University of Pretoria is the apex of our centenary. What Professor Moltmann has stood for throughout his life is now the hope we pursue. Professor Moltmann's topic tonight, as I already indicated, is Future of Theology. I'm looking forward to his lecture because we all know that the position of theology, especially at the public university, is increasingly in question, and theology as such needs to be redefined. Professor Moltmann, it's now my sincere privilege to give you the opportunity to address the audience.
Does my voice is loud enough? Okay. My heart is overwhelmed with gratitude and joy to see the new South Africa. What I'm trying to say at the beginning, my heart is overwhelmed with gratitude to you, Johann Beutendag, and with joy over the new South Africa. I have vivid memories of 40 years ago, and I can assure you that you made big steps into the living future. Now I'm turning to my lecture. It came to my mind, every body who believes and thinks to try to understand what he believes is a theologian, not only the students at Pretoria or Tübingen, not only the professors, but everybody who believes and tries to understand what he believes is already a theologian and must be addressed by learned theologians. The future of theology. Whoever asks about the future must understand the present. I'm beginning, therefore, with theology after 1945. Where is theology in the West now? In the second part, I shall try to conceive the necessary ecological term of modern theology today. And in the third part, the pneumatological turn of Christian theology coming from independent non-Constantinian churches in Asia and Africa. Then in part four, I shall answer the questions about the future of theology with my own theology of the future, as expected. Theology today. Theology is always in a triangle. A triangle of church, the public, and the academy. Theology takes place in the pulpit, in the marketplace, modern TV, and the lecture hall. Theologians live in the Christian community, the public community, and the academic community. In formerly Christian countries, that is still the theological consolation. First, church theology. In post-war Germany, theology was again close to the church. Theology is a function of the church, we read in Karl Barth and Paul Tillich. The theological faculties and state universities had been corrupted by the Nazis. The confessing church was the only group that resisted and founded two church faculties in Berlin and in Wuppertal. Karl Barth's theology was church dogmatics. Rudolf Bultmann's theology was charismatic theology. The Bauman Declaration of 1934 was a model of confessing theology. We affirm and we reject, yes or no. There's no middle ground. The advantage of this church theology, in this way, theology could influence the churches and exclude cultural delusions, for example, political ideologies. The disadvantage, a Christian in-group mentality took over, and theology became a preaching to the choir. Second, political theology. In my generation, some of us young theologians wanted to break out of this inland traffic of church theology. From about 1960, a theology with a face to the world emerged, as Johann Baptist Metz, my friend, proclaimed. In the Christian Marxist dialogue, we developed a new political theology of Christianity. Carl Schmitt's old political theology was a theology of state sovereignty, not of the church. And we worked on an after Auschwitz theology for Germany. We started with a heavy burden of Auschwitz and war crimes of the German army in the East. More effective worldwide was liberation theology, which started in 1971 in Latin America. Contextual theologies mushroomed everywhere. Black theology, feminist theology, Minjung theology, socialist theology, and Dalit theology in India. These were theological participations in political or cultural movements. To bring Christians into these movements, and hopefully to Christianize them. In the World Council of Churches, the anti-racism program was controversially debated, but prepared the way for the downfall of the apartheid regime in South Africa. The advantage of political theology: theology is publicly recognized, even considered as dangerous, as in my own life in 1976, when South Africa denied a visum for me because they thought a revolutionary theologian is coming. And in any case, debated in newspapers and journals such as the New York Times or in Germany, Der Spiegel. The disadvantage of political theology: the context becomes the text of theology. The world is writing the agenda for Christian theology. Number three, academic theology. Strangely enough, these political theologies lost their attraction after the end of the East-West conflict around 1990 and the beginning of globalization. The last and very good political theology was a political theology of peace during the peace movement in divided Germany at the beginning of the 80s against nuclear armament. And this was influential for the massive demonstrations in Leipzig and other cities in 1989, beginning with the peace prayers in the Nikolaikirche in Leipzig. But after 1990, young theologians turned to the academic community and tried to win recognition in the world of science, beginning with dialogues of theology and physics, theology and law, theology and medicine, ecological theology and earth sciences. In 1991, the church-related theological faculties in Berlin and Wuppertal were closed and the faculties transferred to the universities. But, however, with the Bologna accreditation process in Europe, these universities in Germany and everywhere in Europe were transformed into clusters of professional schools, Berufsschulen, and lost their character as truth-seeking communities, as my friend John Polkinghorne described an ideal vision of the scientific community. Research institutes of the university became closed to industry and wherever in a university there is a truth seeking community in science, theology is at home. The advantage of academic theology wins recognition in the university world. The disadvantage, theological faculties and divinity schools are somewhere and sometimes changed over into departments of religious studies, for example, in the USA. In Tübingen, we have a Protestant faculty since more than 400 years, and a younger Catholic faculty of 150 years, and an Institute for Islamic Studies. And we are separated, but work together. Each of us with his own comes into the community. Full Christian theology must, in my understanding, hold the triangle together: church, the public, and the academy, as an all-embracing function of the kingdom of God, the kingdom of truth. Theology is a special function of the church and a special function of the people and a special function of truth-seeking communities in the world of sciences. With this remark, I move to the ecological turn of theology today. We are standing today at the end of the modern age and at the beginning of the ecological future of our world, if our world is to survive. A new paradigm is emerging in which human culture and the nature of the earth are differently bound together than in the paradigm of the modern age. The modern age was determined by the seizure of power by humans over the earth and the elements and energies of nature. As an image of God, the human being is exceptional in the dominium terra, lordship over the earth is his destiny. The climate crisis of today shows the limits of the modern paradigm. In Paris, at the end of 2015, at the United Nations conference, the community of nations, for the first time, listened to the cry of the earth. It took more than 400 years to develop the modern world. We do not have as much time to build an ecological culture. We need a new concept of nature of the earth and a new image of the human being and the human destiny. And with this a new experience of God in our culture and nature. A new ecological theology can help. But why, after all, theology, because the understanding of nature and the self-understanding of humans in the modern age were coined by our modern anthropocentric theology and ethics. There is, however, an old ecological joke. Where two planets meet somewhere in the universe, ask the one, "How are you, my friend?" Answer the others, "I feel very bad. I am sick. I have Homo sapiens." Says this first. "Oh, I'm really sorry for you. That's really bad. I have had that plague also. But don't worry, it passes." With this, the planetary perspective on humankind is opened up. We recognize ourselves with the eyes and the interests of the blue planet Earth. We begin to ask ourselves, will this human sickness of the Earth pass because we are doing away with ourselves, or because humankind is becoming wise and is healing the wounds we are inflicting on the Earth up till today? Behind this practical question of our survival, there awaits a deeper question. Are we a sickness on the Earth? Are we a failure of the evolution of life? Are we an unfortunate creature of God who already repented to having created us, as we read in Genesis 6, verse 6? This is the true existential question of humankind. Are we here only by chance or by providence? What are our place and our task in the Earth community? I shall not speak here about the changes required in anthropology or the doctrine of creation, but instead present my latest ideas to change the so-called world religions into Earth religions, with reverence for the Earth. And the Earth religion is the biblical Sabbath of the land. My argument in three steps is that we are moving from world politics to an earth politics. Until World War II, the human world was organized in nations, and politics meant national politics. Global affairs led to international treaties. In the next step, a universal ecological or atomic dangers were growing, we had to change our national foreign politics into world home politics, as Carl Friedrich von Weizsäcker said. Out of international treaties, we had to build up transnational institutions like, for example, the European Community or the United Nations. In a third step, today, climate change has become universal, and we must use world home politics and transnational institutions for a common Earth politics. The Paris Conference of the United Nations in 2015 was the first step giving the Earth a say in global human affairs. My question was, why don't we transfer this way to what we call world religions? There are many religions, ideologies, and cultures of humankind, but only one Earth. Gaia, our poor blue planet, our mother, our home. We ask critically, what are the contributions of these world religions with their customs and ethics to the ecological crisis? And what can these religions contribute to a new respect for life and for the earth? We used to understand the earth as a space for human life and as a place for the encounter of human cultures and religions. Now we need to learn to respect the earth as a subject with reactions to humankind's actions. The Hebrew Bible offers us a religion of the earth, a religion of the planet Earth, in form of the suppers of the land. Every seventh year, the people of Israel are to leave the land fallow. First, for a social reason, that the poor of your people may eat, and second, for a religious reason, so that the land may celebrate the great Sabbath of the Lord, an ecological imperative that the land may regenerate its energies and become fruitful again. The promise, if the people observe the Sabbath of the land, they will live securely. The warning, if they don't, and they exploit the land non-stop, they must leave the land, for example, for 70 years. This is an amazing early ecological interpretation of the Babylonian exile of Israel and a warning to us. If we fail to observe the earth religion and the Sabbath of the land, the Sabbath of the water, and the Sabbath of the air, deserts will grow and the water of the oceans will be polluted by plastics, and the air in our cities will become smoke over the cities. And eventually the human race will disappear from the earth. The earth will survive, humans not. what can we Christians do about it? Christianity may change from the traditional Gnostic spirituality. We are only guests on earth. Our homeland is in heaven. To seeing that the earth is our home in this world and also in the world to come, because we expect the new earth on which righteousness dwells. We are faithful to the earth. German children learn the prayer, "Lieber Gott, mach mich fromm, dass ich in den Himmel komme." If our home is in the beyond, in heaven, why care for the earth? If we are only guests on earth, we are not responsible for the guest house. When the guest house becomes a veil of tears, we disappear into heaven. Before we work on earth, we are in fact taken from the earth and return to the earth. Spirituality develops where God's spirit is expected and experienced. If the spirit is in the human soul, is spirituality of the soul and of heaven is developed. If the spirit is poured out on all flesh, a spirituality of life emerges. We need a new spirituality of our senses. "You awaken all my senses," we sing at Pentecost. With awakened senses, we can see and taste God's presence in all good things. As we see and taste God's mercy in the sacraments, a sacramental spirituality of the earth is at stake today, as Orthodox theologians proposed already decades ago in the World Council of Churches. Number three, the pneumatological turn. There is a new Christianity emerging in Asia, Oceania, and Africa. South Korea is one of its centers in Asia. What is new of this Christianity? They are non-Constantinian churches. There were never and are not state churches. The Philippines and Ethiopia are exceptions. What is a Constantinian church? Our old Constantinian churches have had a sacrum imperium, a sacred empire. Is in the new Christianity in Asia, Oceania, and Africa, they have only the Holy Spirit to protect them. After Constantine, the Roman emperors made Christianity the state religion, as is well known, and the empire, the Holy Kingdom of Christ. As Christ reigns from heaven, so they are ruling on earth. The so-called Constantinian turn of affairs was apocalyptically interpreted as a turn from persecution to dominion, from martyrdom to the millennium. The Christian state church was not organized as a church, but as a millennium. They shall be priests of God and of Christ, and shall reign with him 1,000 years, we read in Revelation 26. This is a well-known hierarchy of the priests over the lay people. This is the parochial system of the state religion, which replaced the congregational principle of the church. You belong to a church wherever you live in Germany. You are not asked to join a church. The saint of the Christian imperial religion was Saint George, killing the dragon, the enemy of God and of the Sacrum Imperium, was depicted as a dragon. After the papal revolution in the Middle Ages liberated the church from the Christian emperor, the Reformation turned to state religions again. Cuius regio, eius religio. Who owns the land determines the religion. Therefore, Tübingen is Protestant and the next town, Rottenburg, is Catholic. In spite of the French Revolution and the American Revolution, we in Europe still live in the old Constantinian nations, in the structures of the Sacrum Imperium as a privileged majority religion. In Scandinavia more than in France, in Europe more than in the USA. The non-Constantinian churches are Christian minorities in Buddhist, Shinto, Islamic, and socialist countries because they are not state religions. They are organized as enterprise in the free market with management structures, with church growth programs and global missions. The churches are centers of worship, education, and social services. The threefold blessing of Reverend David Yonggi Cho in Korea: salvation for the lost, healing for the sick, prosperity for the poor, and community for the lonely crowds in Asian megacities. Their interreligious dialogue is not focused on what they have in common with the majority religion, but on what is special and unique in Christian faith. The dialogue doesn't serve the general secular tolerance as ours do, but the self-assurance of Christians in the mission of the gospel. And the last point is important. These churches are pre-millenarian and free churches. they are not millenary statues of the sacred empire. Second, I had not planned a book on the Holy Spirit. After my book on Christology, I discovered a missing link to eschatology, the doctrine of the Holy Spirit. I was like the people who talk of the second coming of Christ and miss the present coming of Christ in the Spirit. I followed the old doctrine of the threefold coming of Christ. Christ came in the flesh, comes in the Spirit, and is coming in glory. I began with a name. If one hears the name Holy Spirit, one is immediately reminded of a service in a beautiful church. We think of something holy, like the Christmas oratory of Johann Sebastian Bach. If we were asked, when did you last feel the spirit of life? Then we can answer with everyday life experiences. So I used the term spirit of life instead of Holy Spirit. Then the Holy Spirit is a passion for life and vitalizing energies of life. I followed the creed and called the Holy Spirit Dominum et Vivificantem, the life-awakening power of God. The love of life that the Spirit creates in us is also a political side. It is creating a culture of life against the present barbarism of killing. Your young people love life, our young people love death, confessed the late Mullah Omar of the Taliban in Afghanistan. And indeed, we have to face a new religion of death. Death can be fascinating, to kill and being killed. The existential question whether humankind should be or not is answered neither by the anthropic principle in the universe nor the evolution of life. It is a matter of faith, and Christians believe that God so loved the world that his own Son became human flesh, human life. This life-giving spirit is poured out on all flesh, and at the end is the resurrection of the flesh into life of the world to come will take place. So everything is around the flesh, the life. Kolbazar is in Hebrew, all the living. We need this unique yes of God to encourage our small and fragile yes to life, to fight against the love of death and the worshipping of killings, and to engender hope for the survival of humankind in peace and justice on earth. my book, The Spirit of Life, 1991, brought me surprisingly into contact with the oldest and the youngest churches, with the Orthodox theology of Dumitru Staniloae, my fatherly friend in Romania, and with the best Pentecostal theology of Yonggi Cho of the Yeouidol Full Gospel Church in Seoul, Korea. With the Orthodox, I agreed on a Trinitarian doctrine of the Spirit without the Western filioque. We had discussed this and decided this in the Klingenthal Conferences of Faith and Order in 1978 and 79. With the Pentecostals in Korea and Latin America, I agreed on a new eschatological interpretation of the experience of the energies of life-giving spirit. They are not only fire from heaven, but powers of the world to come, as we read in Hebrews 6, verse 5. The old eschatological interpretation of the Spirit in Pentecostal circles was dispensationalism. The world is aging, and today is the last stage of the world. I believe I have convinced at least some of them on a new dynamic hope eschatology for the experience of the Spirit. And with this, I come to my last point. The future of theology is for me a theology of the coming God. You wouldn't have expected anything else from me, would you? All theological efforts in my life have been dedicated to an ecumenical Christian theology of hope or of the coming of God. But it is completely uncertain whether the coming generations of theologians will follow me. After all, we, some 50 years ago, did not follow our teachers either. The future of theology may emerge totally differently from what we old prophets expect. The main thing is not this or another tradition, but to begin anew with the origin of Christian faith. I have only a few remarks on the theology of the coming God. First, the conversion to the future. The future is for any messianic theology not only an eschatological topic, but also a broad place, der weite Raum, where theology can move its ideas freely and hopefully, as birds need fresh air to fly. Christian theology needs the wide space of God, makom in Hebrew. With the theology of hope in 1964, I participated in a general conversion to the future that happened after World War II, prepared by philosophers who developed their ideas before World War I, such as Alfred North Whitehead and Ernst Bloch. The World Council of Churches followed with the Uppsala Assembly in the important year 1968 under God's promise, "Behold, I make all things new." And the various liberation theologies spoke for the future of the poor and the hopeless and desperate people. Christian hope is not only hope for eternity. Yes, that is an important dimension, but also messianic hope for our concrete future on earth. We seek freedom and salvation in the coming dangers and take our chances. This messianic hope is a healing power against the arrogance of the powerful and against the apathy of the powerless. With this faith, we will be able to hew out of the mountain of despair a stone of hope, as Martin Luther King Jr. proclaimed in 1963. The God of hope is a coming God, the God who is and was and who is to come. God is not the eternal, unchangeable, not the unrelated absolute, who is and was and will be the same from eternity to eternity, but the God who has made the future of his own creation, God's time, and who is coming to fill heaven and earth with divine life and divine truth and divine righteousness. This is the promise of Israel's Exodus and Shekinah story and of Christ's incarnation and resurrection story, and is even the last word in the New Testament, "Surely I come quickly, amen, even so, come Lord Jesus." And in the end is the beginning. That is the second point. Whoever thinks about the future of our world meets with pessimistic, apocalyptic speculations about the end of the world in religion as well as in literature and movies. The end has always a certain fascination. For whom? Especially for the richer nations and the upper classes who think that they have something to lose if the end is coming. Some spoke of the end of the of all things. Modern philosophers speak of the end of history. And the Protestant eschatology of the Lutheran, Paul Althaus, has the title Die letzten Dinge, The Last Things. And the Catholic theologian Hans Urs von Balthasar calls his last book of the theodrama series Das Endspiel, The Final Match. I started my theology with the resurrection of Christ. This is indeed the unique eschatological event in this world of sin and death, in this history of violence and killing. The future which this event opens up has nothing to do with the end, but on contrary, with the beginning. The beginning of eternal life, the beginning of the new creation of all things, the beginning of the glory of the coming God. Eschatology is not about the last things of this world, but about the first things about the world to come. And this influences our thinking. What hope brings into our reason is an immanent transcending. Thinking means transcending. Denken heißt überschreiten, said Ernst Bloch, and this wording is on his gravestone in Tübingen. Denken heißt überschreiten. Thinking means transcending. By the powers of hope, we are crossing the limits of the present into the future. Transcending means crossing the limits of reality into the sphere of the possible. The firm land of reality is always surrounded by an ocean of possibilities. The realized possibilities are only a small part of the possible realities. Therefore, possibility stands above reality. And theological thinking is, to put it simply, thinking something through to the end. It makes a difference whether we think of death at the end of life or resurrection into eternal life, whether we expect an annihilation of the world as the end of all things or the new creation of all things. The theological power of imagination sees this mortal life in the future of the eternal life which comes, and this human history in the future of the coming God's judgment and kingdom. Eschatological thinking draws God's future into the human present and opens the human present for God's coming. My final word is, in this way, theology becomes a gateway to the future of the people and the earth. Or as Johann Boitendijk used to say, the Obmark van die Hecke. Thank you.